And praise the Lord. Good evening. Good evening, my dear sisters and brother. And we know that our other beloved sisters and brother will tune in. Yeah. So fearless living. I think for me, it's really very timely to be realizing things actually. Parang ano eh, parang Romans 8:28 talaga. All things work together for good. Even though, if you think about it, parang I have some things that needs to be adjusted, yung ganyan. In my mind, so I go, what if? Okay, Joe, all things work together for good because I love you. So, fearless living. Psalms 91:5-6. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night. So dun nandun pa din tayo ha. So yung terror actually in the Hebrew is pakad. So it's terrifying fear. So parang ano yung natatakot ka dun sa iniisip mong kinakatakutan. Parang yung the thing that you are fearful of, you are expecting it to happen to you. Ang ganyan. Isaiah 41, 12-13 in the New King James. You shall seek them and not find them. Those who contended with you, those who war against you shall be as nothing. As a non-existent thing, for I, the Lord your God, will hold, there it goes again, your right hand, saying to you, fear not, I will help you. Fear not, I will help you. But this is made clearer. Actually, okay. Yung fear dyan, yung pakad, is fear for your own safety. It is a fear that is eating away at you. It is a subtle fear or dread. A fear that destroys any attempt to enjoy life. You can't eat, you can't sleep. All you can think about is this dread. Itong Isaiah 41, 12-13, when you look at the original KJV, thou shalt seek them and shalt not find them. Even them that contended with thee, they that war against thee shall be as nothing and as a thing of naught. O diba talagang old English, no? For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. So yung a thing of naught in the Hebrew is ke'epem. Ke'epem. This word is rendered as nothing. But when you trace this word to its Semitic root, you will find it, you'll find that it has the idea of the bottom of your foot or the sole of your foot. So pag sinabing gano'n ni Lord na, don't fear not, I will help you, because it's actually something, it's a thing of naught, which is under the sole of your foot. So as the word evolved through the various Semitic languages, it eventually carried the idea of the extreme portion of your body that is the ankle or sole of your foot. So the word ke'epem is prefix with a cap, indicating a preposition like, which means like or as. So it means all our enemies are like the sole of your foot. They are under you. Like walking on an ant, the sole of your foot will crush it. O, dun pala nang galing yung, you will crush it. You will crush it. So God is not saying your enemies are really not out there. They are there. They're very real, but they are at such an extreme length from you that they hardly matter. Just like what President Calvin Coolidge, President of America before. If you see 10 troubles coming down the road, you can be sure that 9 will run into the ditch before they reach you. Ah, ganda, no? So if the enemy does reach you, then all you have to do is simply stomp your feet. Diba? All you have to do is simply need to step on them. Diba? Step on your authority, because diba? Everything is placed under your feet. Everything is placed under the feet of the Lord. And you are in Christ. Ay, walang ibig sabihin ng fear not. So, which takes us back again to Marie Curie. Nothing in life is to be feared. It is only to be understood. Now is the time to understand more, so that we may fear less. Si Marie Curie, who discovered two important chemistry elements, right? So in the New King James Version, this very big, ang sinasabi ni Mercury, di ba, you have to know. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So eternal life is knowing Him, knowing His thoughts about you. Yun yun eh. In the Strong's Concordance, it's ginosko, so to come to know, to recognize, and perceive the depth and the height, right, and the breadth of His love for you. To know that you are loved, right? So, ang sabi ni Lord, John 17:24, let them see my glory. In Christ, we have come to that day when we can see His glory. In John 17:24-26, Father, I desire that they also, whom you have gave me, may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. And praise the Lord, because the Lord Jesus spoke these words before the cross. And now we are in Him. And sabi niya, which you have given me, for you love me before the foundation of the world. The same degree, the same intensity that the Father's love has for Jesus is the same degree and intensity that Abba loves you and I. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you. And these have known that you sent me. And I have declared to them your name. The name of Abba is over you and I. And I will declare it, that the love with which you love me may be in them, and I in them. Praise the Lord. Colossians 3 verse 1 says, He says, since you have been raised with Christ. Since. It is very, it's with an emphatic exclamation mark. No? Since, know that you have been raised with Christ. The verb raise is in aorist indicative tense, meaning it was finished. It is a finished action at a specific point in time. When was that specific point in time? When He was raised, we were raised. One glorious co-resurrection. Colossians 3:4. Paul says, you know, this is the key, no? That realizing that we are raised together with Him. I heard this one preacher, the problem in the mainstream church is that we really don't have a grasp that we've been made the righteousness of God in Christ, and therefore we were co-raised with Him. Colossians 3:4, Paul says, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Those five words, Christ, who is your life. Christ, who is your life. Who is your life? Christ. Hallelujah. The word appear isn't referring to the second coming of Christ. It means to make manifest, to make known, to become graspable. Meron palang word na ganun. The root is light. The same word is used in the last part of the verse. We will also appear. So what is Paul saying here? Christ is our life. When that becomes known or graspable, or when we have this awareness or understanding, when we know, when the light of who He is as our life shines in us, then we are able to grasp and know who we are. We will grasp and know who we are in glory. In dokyo, yung root word is doxa. The light will go on in us, and we will grasp and know who we are as the view and opinion of God. We are who He says we are, as well as being the tangible manifestation of Him on earth. Paul says in Galatians 2 that his life now in the physical body is the life of Christ. His life in our physical body. Diba? He's the functionary of our tabernacle. He's the functionary of our sanctuary. Perfection in our spirits, right? It's the same expectation that we should have for our tabernacles. His life in our physical body. Is there nothing more glorious? What is true of Him as He is, so are we in this world. What is true of Him is equally true of us, sinless, full dominion over death, divine health, glorified. Hallelujah. It is finished. So, now, how do we navigate this truth continually in our lives? Because we live day to day, right? So, counting the Omer marks the beginning of the barley harvest. In ancient times, Jews would bring the first sheaves to the temple as a means of thanking God for the harvest. Omer means to utter speech. Homologio, confession, to verbally count the days. In the vernacular, yung common language, it is to speak positive, right? Ganun yun, no? But it's much more than speaking positive. It is a 49-day transition between the second night of Passover, Pesach, and the holiday of Pentecost. It is a transition. So, Ben, parang chinare ko last week, no? Parang I was in a transition. So, maybe you are also in a transition. You are in a state of, okay, man, you are believing that you are healed, but the manifestation, you are in transition, right? So a transition from deliverance into an outpouring from heaven, an outpouring of His Spirit. So in this transition period, it is very important to verbally, Omer, verbally count the days with declarations. What are those declarations? Declarations of His promises over our lives, of whom we are in Christ, and all of that Christ purchased for us through His death and resurrection. Angels, ayan, ito maganda dito. Angels are not activated when we don't participate. Angels are activated as we declare His word. Psalms 103 verse 20. And in Daniel 10 verse 2, I have come for your words. So when we are, kasi ano tayo, no? Hindi nga tayo nagsispeak ng negative, pero hindi naman din tayo nagde-declare, right? So we are refusing to speak the negative, but then we are not actively saying, declaring over our lives the words. But syempre, may mga days no, na ganun, but the Lord is saying to us now, Daniel 10:2, hey, yung angel, I have come for your words. His angels are poised and ready to work on your behalf, to obey God's word that we have been declaring. Hallelujah. This is so powerful. No? Actually, parang ngayon ko lang na-realize versus last week. So what will you declare during these transition periods? It's not a time to plead. It's not a time to beg for healing, prosperity, favor, but rather a time to boldly declare what is already yours in Christ. For instance, rather than praying, oh, please, please, heal me or my family, instead of declaring that, then we say, Jesus, thank you. You're my healer, and by your stripes, my body is healed. It's not going to be healed, but it's healed already. Instead of saying, God, please save my family, begin to boldly declare, Jesus, you died for my family. Your death on the cross provided salvation for them. I just command right now that the blinders fall off their eyes and they will experience your delivering power in their lives. So I call them save. I call myself save from any problems and set free now today. So let us be encouraged. I encourage you to think about what you want to declare in this season and write it out. Let's get into the word and find out what God has to say. Faith begins where the will of God is known. What is the will of God for you? The will of God for you and I is not to be sick. The will of God is for us to be whole, for us to be abundant. Find the scriptures that says He's our healer, provider, deliverer, etc. Then boldly declare Him as such in your life. Sabi nga, I have come, Daniel, for your word. If the word says He's your healer, then healing is always the will of God. Once you're settled on His will for you, it's easy to boldly declare His promises as yes and amen in Christ Jesus. In the Mirror translation, Colossians 1:9b to 14, our constant desire for you is that you might be overwhelmed with the knowledge of God's dream for your life. But when I was reading this, no, I cannot help but to be blown away. You know that we dream for our children, we dream for our teams in the office, right? But the Lord God is saying, you, my dream for you is so big. My thoughts for you are so, so big, and you cannot even begin to, comprehend. We pray that the pattern of His wisdom and thoughts, but the Lord wants us to be filled with the pattern of His wisdom and thoughts, and it will fall into place for you in all spiritual understanding. Yung tsunami means joining together. Diba ito yung kaba in Hebrew? Our thoughts infused with His thoughts, our thoughts entwined with His thoughts. It's a fusion of our thoughts. Go on a walkabout tour. Peripateo means to walk about everywhere, to explore the extent of the land that is already ours under His Lordship. Now, you can conduct appropriately towards Him, pleasing Him in every harvest of good works that you bear. Meanwhile, you continue to increase in your intimate acquaintance with that which God knows to be true about you. So John 17 verse 4, no, the knowledge of God is not our perception of Him. Oh? The knowledge of God is not our perception of Him, but His knowledge of us. How He thinks about you and I. To know even as we have always been known, this results in the most attractive and fulfilled life possible. Walk about tour, it is walking through the Word and exploring what belongs to you and me through Christ Jesus. So beautiful. So, asking and believing, aka using our faith. In Mark 11, 24, because many of us have very specific prayers, right? Healing, provision, success, victory. Mark 11, 24, therefore, conclusive, right? And it's again an exclamation point. I say to you, whatever. There, yung word na yan, whatever. What is it that you want, right? Daniel, I've come for your word. Sabi niya, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Asking and believing are present tense verbs, present and continual. And that is exactly what we've been taught about this verse. Ask and believe again, over and over, until we receive what we've been asking and believing for. But you know what? The word receive is in aorist. Diba? Aorist means in the Greek complete. In other words, it's finished tense. Done. So what does this mean? We're not being told in this verse to ask and believe until our faith is strong enough to receive what we've been asking and believing for. No. What we are to understand in this verse is that when we come to the realization, when we come to the agreement with God, when we come to the realization that we have already received, then we will have it. Again, it's so good. When we come to the realization that we have already received, then we will have it. In other words, when we understand that receiving is already a finished work. 2 Peter 1:3 says that we have been given all things that pertain to life and godliness. There is not anything else to receive. We've been given all. So when we realize that we have been asking and believing for already exists, Amy, in us, then we will have it. Or in the Greek, the word have is our English translation of the Greek word Amy, meaning to be or exist or I am. It is already in us. We just have to be aware and realize it. What have you been asking and believing for? Healing, finances, victory, peace, wisdom, etc. You know, I'm not saying that I've arrived there, no. The reason why it is here, it's now being proclaimed to you and me, including me, because I need to hear this, that it is already in me. Diba? Dekomai, ito yung mamaya ba, dalaanan natin ulit, no? Realize that it's already a finished work in you. Begins in yourself as I am healed, I am prosperous, I am full of peace, wisdom, love, etc. And it will manifest in your life. It will be. Hallelujah. So, in John, because this is a story of John 21 verse 6. And he said to them, because it's all along it was there, right? The Lord just wants to show and tell, cast your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some. So they cast and now they were not able to. Yung some kay Lord, no? It's so many, right? Multitude of fish. So, di ba, naaral natin dati yung right is dexos, but the original Greek is dekomai. So, it's actually to receive. To receive. To receive what is already there. What is already there? It's your portion. It's your meros. So, meron kasing concept dati na, intayin mo yung God season kasi may season yan. Di ba? God seasons. Most of the prophetic words we hear are about seasons. Seasons of miracle, season of favor, season of restoration, time of breakthrough, etc. Pero, kailan ba yun? Diba? Almost all of this use Old Testament scripture to confirm them. And the focus is on doing. For example, God will release favor in your life if you're faithful or if you're obedient. Diba? As he said. We don't have an issue with the seasons per se. But the problem with season is it keeps us focused on a time frame. Remember that the gospel is out of time, right? One of the aspects of me, one of the aspects, kasi ito yung author sabi niya, is farming. Farming is seasonal, even in California where they farm. They have seasonal crops. If you're not careful, you will catch yourself using catchphrases. That places you in a box. Yan, kasi meron tayong mga born againism na mga phrases eh. Yan, season, abangan mo yung season mo. Prophetic seasons can do the same. They keep us future focused on what Jesus is about to do or going to do instead of what Jesus has already done. They keep us looking at just one thing for the season, such as God's favor, instead of looking at the full finished work of Christ in our lives and the truth that has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness now. Yung word na season, actually naaral natin to before eh. Yung et. In Hebrew, it's made up of ayin and tav. Ayin in Hebrew is the idea of seeing and watching as well as knowledge. Ayin, Genesis 6:8 refers to the eyes of the Lord, a word describing an eye or insight or seeing or perceiving with God's perspective. Claro, no? And tav in Hebrew means cross or the sign of the covenant. So, God's season in our life are all comprised of seeing things from the perspective of the gospel, from the perspective of the finished work, from the perspective that Jesus and his finished work has done. In every season of our lives, we should expect that the finished work to be in operation in your life and in my life. No matter what a natural season, no matter what happened to you last week, just like me, no, may look like, it is still a season of favor. It is still a season of abundance. It is a season of health, goodness, grace, wisdom, breakthrough, prosperity, sonship, freedom, deliverance, etc. Luke 4:19 says, Jesus declared it a year of God's favor or a year of jubilee. Year is a cycle of time, a season. The root word for jubilee in Hebrew is yabal, which means to flow. Jesus provided a continual flow for us in every season of our life because of the finished work. You don't just have a season of favor, a season of peace, or a time of abundance. We have a lifetime of continual fulfillment of all things that he has provided for us for life and godliness. We should still read prophetic words that come across our paths about season, but now we read them as a reminder of what Jesus has done and what is already yours and what is already mine. Not dependent on what we do, but ours by inheritance. We read them as God highlighting certain things that are part of the finished work so that we can grow in our knowledge of them. Gain more understanding. Diba? Sabi ni Marie Curie, nothing is to be feared, only to be understood. Gain more understanding of these things so that we can walk in victory. What did the finished work of the cross provided? That's your season. That's my season. Walk in the revelation of it. Walk in the victory of it. Hallelujah. So, Daniel 10 verse 2. The angel told Daniel, I have come for your words. I have come for your words. What are you saying, Joe? What are you declaring? Our words speak forth what is stored in our hearts. His faith is stored in our hearts. We don't have to rely on our faith, on our own faith. We simply, like Paul, live our new lives by the faith of the Son of God, resting in his faith, speaking forth in his faith, saying what he knows to be true about us, forming our now world. How do we form our now world? By speaking forth, by speaking words of faith that says, I am righteous, I am holy, I am complete in him, I have abundant life, I am filled to the full with the fullness of the Godhead. He's the health of my body. I have all things that pertain to life and godliness. I am saved, I am healed, delivered, and all the five areas of my life, physical, spiritual, mental, social, and financial. I have no lack. I walk in favor. This is what faith, his faith in you, understands. So let's go find out what God says about you and I and begin to speak it forth and watch, ayan, about the manifestation of his abundant life begin to form our world in this lifetime, in this world. Because in heaven, everything there is abundant. Because faith understands just like Abba. How did Abba created the world, right? He created the world by his words. So we also frame our world by our words. So again, the angel is asking, I have come for your words. I have come for your words. And that, my dear sisters and brother, is chapter 5, part 2.
So let's have our communion for tonight. Let's hold the bread in our hand. And we, together we declare, thank you, Jesus, for your broken body. Thank you for bearing the symptoms and sicknesses at the cross, so that today we might have your health and wholeness. Declaring that by your stripes, by the beatings that you bore, by the lashes which fell on your back, we are completely healed. And we believe tonight we receive your resurrection life in our body. And Lord, we declare that in our body is the fullness of God. So as we partake, we declare the same life. Renewal, not just with youth, but with the strength and restoration of good health in our body right now. Amen. Let's partake of the bread. Now let's take the cup in our hands, and together we declare, thank you, Jesus. Because of your blood, we become one. We begin the righteousness of God in Christ. That we are forgiven forever, accepted in the beloved forever. Thank you for your blood, not just made us one, but has bought us forgiveness and acceptance. So as we drink today, we celebrate. We celebrate all the things that belongs to us. The inheritance of the righteous, which includes preservation, restoration, healing, wholeness. The power to declare your word and to see it happen in our lives, Lord. This week, we thank you for that exciting revelation of your word. As we partake today, we believe we have it now.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.